you very much for having me here. I do have some interesting things to go over. Before we go forward, I'd like to go back and kind of introduce a little bit more who I am. I am a professional land surveyor, registered in multiple states. I am a consultant, back to the engineering community. And also, I'm a certified trainer too, so I do provide training for software and technical products, which helps people integrate what they have and improve what they do in terms of workflows and things like that. Working as a land surveyor, I've gone all the way from Alaska all the way down to down to Texas regions, and some of those projects that I've worked on, they have allowed me to get into some pretty interesting places. Like for instance, I did the retracement for the Sunrise, Alaska. It's one of the first mining towns. It's now a ghost town. And going through that area, we walked through the town. There's the cabins are still there in place. And if you walk inside the cabins, there's still a place sitting on the table. This is going back, well back behind the 1800s. It's like someone just left yesterday. It was really amazing to go through that and see that, that it's kind of a time stamp in time. And it's very interesting stuff. It was very challenging environments up there. I don't know if you guys have been up there, but you ever heard of Devil's Club? It's a very tall plant. And if you step on it, it runs along the ground first, and then it goes up, and through the stalk of it, it's like in the land of the lost, this plant. And if you step on the stalk on the ground, it'll club you in the head as you go. So there's definitely environmental, out there in the field, we do come across a lot of things. Focusing back on, down in Texas area, the Beaumont area, we did the Big Thicket National Preserve. You guys ever seen banana spiders? But they're literally this big. They're huge spiders. So if you go down the line, 3 days after you cut that line, you see this huge web and the spider that's on it. It's talking about giving you the heebie-jeebies. It really does give you a whole new perspective on going out into the field and that. Going through my experience, down in the borderland areas, did some work down there, and for the federal government, doing a retracement of the international boundary lines there, Texas, New Mexico, and Mexico, we did see a lot of activity in terms of, people coming across the border. We've actually, were stopped, my crews were stopped by the Border Patrol, and they asked if there's any weapons on board, and we, of course, said no, we don't have any. So they said, well, maybe you should consider start having some weapons on board. And this was 20 miles to the side of our sovereign territory of the United States. So yeah, there's definitely some high risk areas that you have to consider as you go through the United States here. So the reason why I bring up all these experiences I had in the past is that our technology today allows us to remotely sense and do the same kinds of workflows we've done in the past. And so we don't have to deal with those huge banana spiders. We don't have to deal with, gun runners or anybody like that. We can provide a solution that allows us to do this even better than we had before. Moving forward, this is, my talk is on about getting the mobile mapping and UAV solutions, integrating those together, which has been done this in the past, more or less, in terms of using sonar, things like that. It has been integrated into mobile map, as you can see from this demonstration here. Down the bottom, the colorized areas, that's sonar and bathymetric surveys going through that trench area where they were trying to as-built that bridge coming across. And it gives a very detailed picture when you stitch those two data sets together and provide a more of a complete picture. As you can see at the top, that blackened area, that's the water going through that area. You don't have that complete picture going out, going through that. And then even further, go above, the air above it, so there's incomplete data sets if you go through this mobile mapping solution, which is basically a corridor that you're going through very precisely. You're getting good data. I've talked to people who are getting, proven results, within, a couple of millimeters kind of things. Very, very nice data sets with the mobile mapping. So this is a continuation of getting a complete picture of the site using unmanned aerial systems to supplement this data set. So going through in current things that have been happening, this is something that came across. There's a paper that was presented for LIGO Geosystems High Definition Survey Contest, just happened this past summer, where they are doing this very same thing with terrestrial scanning. As you can see that they went through a study to try to determine if the accuracy and precisions of the UAV can match up to a terrestrial scanner and things of that nature. And they seem to have very good results that came across that. So I wanted to acknowledge their effort on that. That's F3 Associates. They presented this paper to LIGO Geosystems. This is just a quick snapshot of their submission, which they did, I believe, got the first place prize on that. So I wanted to definitely acknowledge their effort in that and their forward thinking as we go into a new way of collecting data. So again, this is still another reinforcement. So you have the gaps in the data corridor. As you can see, this is an interchange, and they drove the interchange all the way around. You can see the corner. In this area here, yeah, they drove through, they came up and down, everywhere they can drive, they did drive. But with an unmanned aerial system, you can actually fill in those gaps right in there also. Right now, that's not part of the data set. So you can think of this really get the whole complete picture of things as we go forward. So that's something that I really think that would really enhance this very proven technology. Also, something else to consider is that the time of day does make a difference. So we can deploy a manned aircraft and collect the same area and then integrate that into the mobile mapping data set. However, it's challenging to for the mission planning. A lot of times you have cloud cover because you're flying pretty good altitudes as you go. So sometimes you can say, well, we can't fly today because there's clouds, things like that, or other constraints, scheduling constraints, where you can drive the job in this day, but you might need an escort to keep the traffic away from you. I don't know if you guys see mobile mappers around, but they got to have a little bit of a space for the traffic so they're not picking up those blips as they go. So you have a lot of mission planning constraints going on. So if you have if you do have maybe a UAS system with you as you go, you can deploy that the same day, collect your data. You don't have to worry about going back and editing, dealing with all the shadowing, the different shadowings from, the aircraft data set as opposed to the mobile mapping data set. So that does help in that regard. Also, we do see that, it's very common for us to see the various industries that are supported by this. As you can see here, we got the survey, the utility industries, the mapping industries, and engineering. But there's actually more coming on board. The precision agriculture industry is now starting to go on board. There's actually a company in Florida, I guess it was their name, I did some research on this. This is the Ag Point, I believe it is. They do providing mobile mapping solutions for citrus growing growers. They can drive through the fields and they can pick up the condition of the plant with that and get some very interesting information for the grower so they can, again, try to improve their crops, get better yields, things like that. What was touched up with Headwall when they talked about their sensing techniques. Well, this is more of a ground-based solution that they are providing also. So I think that does help kind of understand how you can merge these two kind of technologies together and make a very good solution. A little bit of the cost analysis for this, and this is kind of was covered up. I did sit on the workshop on Monday, which is a very good workshop. If you guys haven't seen that, that workshop, I was very pleased by what was presented there. Some of these items were talked about. So this is manned aircraft versus SUAS. I guess there was a presentation on that earlier today too. But yeah, just a little bit of that. You can see, the aircraft, you can cover a large amount of areas, and the unmanned aerial systems, you're talking 1,000 acres or less. There's certain folks that are maybe saying 2,000 acres around there, but roughly you get the point that unmanned aerial systems, you can get some really discrete areas in that, instead of having to deal with managing a manned aircraft. Whenever you get that guy up in the air, you've got to fly that amount in there and get your money back and things like that. So that does reduce your footprint on having to manage these assets, if you will. So it's a little bit more intuitive with the manned aircraft, with the mobile mapping platform, because it handles the same, roughly the same amount of area. And that kind of goes with dispatch management, talking about that, where you have to pair it up, the size of the project matches up much better. And the cost, of course, is dramatically less. These are just general terms in terms of that, but as you can see how the unmanned aerial systems are quite less to deal with and things like that. So we do have federal constraints in terms of restricted flights under general population areas, and you can't just take it out there and do that. So, but with manned aircraft, you can. So that's something that we, as professionals, be stewards and go to the government and say, hey, we do have a viable solution here. We are professionals. We're not here to hurt people. We're here to help and provide a good service, quality service to the community, and maybe kind of be advocates and show that we can do this professionally. So that's something that I would definitely recommend everybody here to try to maybe make an effort to go to the federal government and say, hey, we can do this, or even local governments too. So the no airworthy certificate also is a big thing too. So that does help on your maintenance costs, things like that, with the unmanned aerial systems. Precision analysis here just kind of goes into, again, matching up the unmanned aerial systems with the mobile mapper. The overall corridor that you're grabbing data with the mobile mapper, in general, you've got about 200 meters that you're gathering. And then within 50 meters of the LiDAR head, you're getting some very good results. One centimeter is posted here, but I've talked to people that has customized systems where it's even getting better than that. Taken off the shelf a product, and then they refine it even further and getting some very good results for that. So with unmanned aerial systems, in general, you're getting 2 to 3 centimeters, maybe even a little bit better if you're, if you've got some algorithms going on that can do that. Using the mobile mapper as a hinge, you can, inject unmanned aerial system data sets, and you could, do some sampling rates and you can kind of refine that a little bit better and try to marry that up. And as we can see, going from that, it was done with F3 Associates, that is possible to kind of do some cloud immersion together. There's software out there that allow you to pair those two point clouds together and marry it into one system. So that's nice. I mean, again, some of this stuff is also going by Mr. Anderson's presentation too, which I really did enjoy, that presentation that he did earlier today. So now maybe I'm going to kind of shift gears and going into the point cloud imagery software. Again, this is, you know, my expertise is with Trimble products. But again, there's other products out there that are available. They're very viable products. This is just kind of a little bit of a cost breakdown of what it takes in order to invest in the software with Trimble products. We've got three products that are available, and also UAS Master, I can include that. That is also another one there too. We have Trimble Business Center, it's their flagship software. It's kind of handles all technologies for the most part that they offer. With the GNSS, optical instruments, and now with the photogrammetry coming on board, with the vision technology, and then now, of course, with the aerial system that they have. So, with the handling of the UXBOT and the ZXBOT now, I believe it's called. It's about $20,000 for that one. And then the Trident software that comes in, around $20,000 also. And the Trident software does the mobile mapping systems. And then also, there's a very good tools that you have, Trimble RealWorks, which is, it handles the terrestrial scanning and that sort of thing. It does do some very good surface comparisons. You can see from the top the slide up there, that's what that comes from, where you can actually see sampling various surfaces, and you can see where it doesn't match up, things like that, so you can kind of compare it and do that. So that's what that is. And here we're talking about the workflows that are associated with this. The UX Live data automated processing, that's with the Trimble Business Center. It does take a little bit of time to process that. I've been told that the proximity is about 8 to 10 hours. This is with the 16 gig RAM with dedicated graphics card, things like that. Obviously, we are seeing 32 gigs out there that people are utilizing, so it might speed up that process a little bit. But yeah, so whenever you do a flight, it does have quite a bit of information to process through. So that's what I'm told, about 8 to 10 hours for users out there right now. And then also the Trimble Grid Factory output, you can use LAS file format. And what that does is extract the features, the asset management, and the classic point cloud. What you need to do is you import the mobile mapping LAS file into TBC, and you try to blend that point cloud. That's where you merge the two data sets together. Obviously, you're using Trimble RealWorks, you can do a QA/QC and make sure how to see, import the other raw point cloud from one source to the other, and you can kind of maybe make sure, see how that fits up together. And then when you're all said and done, you do bring that back into Trident, and you can prepare your deliverables there in the Trident software. So that's briefly what I have for that. That's all I have for now. Definitely, if you guys have any further questions, there's my contact information, and I'll be happy to go over anything. Of course, also going through, the Q&A sessions you can get online also would be a good place. So thank you so much.